Hey, this is Rolf for Sluice, Block Ops, here with another video on how to do cryptocurrency mining and some of my strategies for making the most of your small to medium mining facility. So I've got some different mining strategies that I've built up here over the last year and a half that I've been mining. So I'm relatively new compared to some other folks. What I like to do, though, is learn how to mine, research, try out all sorts of things, and then share that information. Some people ask me on my website, where you can ask questions and contact and things like that, why I do this. Well, I'm not looking to make money from these videos. I don't want anybody to invest in anything that I'm doing, and I'm not interested in investing in anything that other people are doing. I believe, however, that small to medium cryptocurrency mining is profitable, that a lot of people should be doing it, and the more people that are mining, the better off the whole cryptocurrency ecosystem is going to be, because it's distributed all over the world. So I'm going to talk a little bit about what it is that I'm doing right now, and I'm planning on doing, including different cryptocurrencies that I'm mining right now. And you can see some of my earlier videos for talking about strategies for small and medium miners. We see in the press about all sorts of big miners that are out there and how they invest $100 million and build big systems. That's cool, but they also have some issues. And some of their issues is that they have investors that they have to please. They have to buy a whole bunch of equipment, and they go down a path and stay on that path. They're not flexible and able to do lots of different things like small to medium miners that like us can do. So where am I? Well, I'm actually in the southeast part of the United States, just north of the city of Atlanta. We've got great electric power prices here. It gets a little hot in the summer, but that's okay. It's also kind of near where I live, so that helps a lot. So I deal with heat, not horrible heat, but it gets up to about 95 degrees Fahrenheit in the middle of the summer here. We ran all through the summer with our systems here, and things went well. So now we're getting into fall and winter mining when the weather's a little bit colder and everything runs a lot more efficiently. I have a good size mining facility that right now has about 140 miners in it, and we're going to get some contractors in here to double the amount of electricity and cooling and things like that. So I'll be able to use hopefully just under 500 kilowatts of electricity going forward here in a few months. Okay, so I'm going to talk about different mining levels, people just getting started, then to people that are really involved in making cryptocurrencies in lots of different ways. Because there's one thing that I discovered over the last, I guess almost 2 years now that I've been doing this, is that mining is just the first step. In order to mine profitably and maximize your mining ability and minimize your taxes and all sorts of different things like that, there's additional strategies and activities that you can do to maximize your earnings potential. Again, that gets into the flexibility, and there's a lot to know and a lot to learn, but take the first step. I mean, I started about 2 years ago. I bought one Bitmain Antminer S9 from a guy on Amazon, and I ran it in my basement. I'm like, wow, this makes me money. And so then I added more, and as soon as I filled up the basement, and my wife wasn't happy about that, I rented a small warehouse and started putting them in there. And then I got into GPU mining and other ASIC mining, then masternodes, and I started researching about more and more cryptocurrencies out there, because I'm a big believer in mining, holding for a while, and then taking profits on a planned profitability path. So let's talk a little bit more about that and the different levels of miners and what they do. When you first start mining cryptocurrencies, it might not feel real to you, and that's okay. With time, you'll come to see that this is really going to be the way that people use money going forward. It takes a while to internalize, so it's okay. So mine whatever cryptocurrency you mine as a level one miner, then trade it for Bitcoin on some exchange like Poloniex or Bittrex or something like that, or an anonymous exchange like Shapeshift. and then sell that Bitcoin for whatever fiat works for you, like US dollars or rubles or whatever works for you. And that gets you immediate money to pay the bills, which is nice because there's electric bills, there's other things you might want to buy. And that's a good way to start. What I've moved to is also doing what I call level two mining. So this is mining and then holding on to what you mine as it goes up in price. Because a lot of these things go up in price. And we've been fortunate this year in 2017 that a lot of different cryptocurrencies have gone up in price. I think as more people see and realize what cryptocurrencies can do and become more comfortable with them, you'll see that continue to go up in price. So I like to trade them to Bitcoin in tranches. So when what I mine goes up in value two times, I'll convert 10% of it to Bitcoin. Same thing when it goes up four times, eight times. By the time it's gone up 50 times in value, which some of the cryptocurrencies that I mine have, pretty much sitting at, you've sold 70% of those. And the rest, hold on to it. You don't want to get into trading it and then selling it high and buying it back later. That takes up a lot of time. You end up sitting in front of your screen all the time instead of doing more productive things. Just hold on to it as long as the project is good. And by this time, if you do have a substantial amount of cryptocurrency from that project, you probably want to find out who the people are that are running it, what their goals are, what their intentions are, and what they're going to do to improve the value of the cryptocurrency over time. So let's talk about the next level of miners. Now, level three mining, here's where things start to get a little bit interesting. So you've been mining, and you've been mining in a currency like, I don't know, Ethereum or Ethereum Classic or Bitcoin or Digibyte or Dash or something like that, and you're like, I'm putting a lot of time and effort and money into mining this, and if I really want to make the profits, I'm going to hold on to it and sell it in tranches, but I want to make sure that the people that are doing this are going to be around for a while and continue to improve this currency. So you start researching it. And so different places that you can research cryptocurrencies are on Bitcoin Talk and the Slack and Telegram, Reddit, forum. And as you're doing this, you'll talk to other people that are mining it and buying it and investing in it. There's a lot of FUD, fear, uncertainty, and doubt out there. There's scammers. It's kind of like a Wild West. So take what people say with a grain of salt and research in a bunch of different areas and synthesize the information and come up with your own opinions. While you're doing this, you can also help other people and have conversations with them. I've had conversations with people all over the world, and it's actually kind of fun. It's a great community of like-minded people. And then you can research to find newer projects to mine. So you can look at Bitcoin Talk announcements and look at them on coinmarketcap.com. You can see what the mining profitability is on coinwars.com and what to mine. So if you are going to research a project, what are the different things that you should look at? Let's talk about that. Here's some of the things that I look at when I'm researching a cryptocurrency project. There's a bunch of different things, and you can go pretty deep. After doing this for a while, you can start to get a feel for whether it's a serious project that has plans and goals and ways to accomplish them, or it's something that somebody is doing on the side, isn't really committed to, or if it's an outright scam. There's a bunch of all of the different types that are out there. So I like to look first at what's the market and purpose? What's the reason that the cryptocurrency exists? And why do the people that are behind it think that they have the best way of addressing the market? And you can take some of the larger cryptocurrencies as an example. You know, Bitcoin is the first. A lot of people treat it as a store of value. And you know, anybody that accepts cryptocurrency for payment, they'll accept Bitcoin. Litecoin is interesting, not only because it's a copy of Bitcoin, but it also does some things sooner than Bitcoin. And there's a different mining algorithm script as opposed to SHA-256, which means it's not really in competition with Bitcoin for mining resources, and that in itself is interesting. Ethereum is completely different. There's been a lot of tokens created on Ethereum, and there's smart contracts, and it has more abilities. It's the first. Now, there are people that have forked Ethereum or done copies of it, and those projects are interesting too, because they have different reasons for existing. Ethereum Classic, Expanse, Ubic. And so those second version or copies or alternatives to the original cryptocurrencies are worth looking at, because sometimes they do things a little bit better. Dash, there's a lot of things that I like about Dash. One of the things is they use a different algorithm than Bitcoin and Litecoin, so it uses X11. And there's a way to fund both the development of it through 10% of the redirection of the mining rewards, and governance, redirection of 45% of the mining rewards towards masternodes. So that's interesting. And then Dash, with the funds for development, is working towards becoming very good at doing payments, quick and easy payments. And there's, because of the X11 miners are just about shipping from Bitmain right now, there's a lot of people that are interested in Dash, and some of the older cryptocurrencies that have been around for 2 to 3 years are actually changing themselves over to the Dash code base, which is well established. So you can look for different projects like those, like Mu, and there's a new one, Helium, Sibcoin. There's a bunch of, we call them Dash clones out there, that are interesting, because you'll be able to point your X11 miners at those in addition to Dash, and once you get some of the cryptocurrency, you'll be able to run masternodes. So running masternodes is a second way of getting profits from your cryptocurrency. Zcash, interesting, because a new technology there of using ZK snarks. So by being able to use both transparent transactions like Bitcoin has and shielded transactions, of being able to send a transaction, but nobody knows who the sender or receiver or the amount was, and include a message. And there's already a few copies of Zcash running around with using the ZK snarks. Komodo's one, there's Hush, there's Zencash, of course, which I'm involved in, and really using these different technologies in different ways. So those all have purposes. BitShares is interesting because it's built upon the graphene technology. I think Dan Larimer is the guy that started that, also did Steemit and Pure Plays, and coming up with EOS. This is not a mineable cryptocurrency, but it's an idea of one that has a completely different market and ability to do things. And then Monero. Monero is, you know, one of the first privacy coins, and has a different way of mining it. And Monero's been doing really well for their price in the market these days. So that's an example of, okay, what's the technology and what's the purpose? Now, my recommendation is that you drill down further, because people are what make things happen. And if you can figure out who the people are that are involved, then you're able to get a feeling for what their motivations are and what the longer term goals are. And further, more you can look at back and see, okay, well, what's the track record that these people have for doing what they say that they're going to do, for being good actors and accomplishing things. So you need to look at leaderships, the developers, and the community. Now, when cryptocurrencies first started, it was all focused on developers and what the developers could do for technology. But as we're continuing to grow, I think people are seeing that it's not all about the developers. It's also about the whole system of getting that cryptocurrency to be successful. There's definitely marketing and partnerships with different exchanges and wallets, and having a community that's supportive and going out and finding people that really need to use your cryptocurrency. One of the cryptocurrencies that I mine in addition to Dash is Mu. I like Mu because it uses the Dash code base. One of the things I don't like is I don't know who the people behind Mu are. So that, I think, kind of puts its price at a lower level, because I'm not really sure what their motivations are, and other people might not be sure either. Anonymity is great in the cryptocurrency world, but you need to be able to have a way of building up trust. There's many ways to build up trust, and one of them is to, over a series, over a while, is just do the things that you say you're going to do, and also explain the things that you're going to do. So I would encourage, for example, the Mu leadership to start writing blog posts on what they want to accomplish, or think about, you know, telling people who they actually are. And then there's other cryptocurrencies like that as well, and being anonymous is fine. And there's a lot of anonymous contributors to Zencash, so I think that can work out well. And it's just, if people are going to spend their time, money, and effort to assist or help promote a cryptocurrency, there's got to be a level of trust, and trust takes time to build. Okay, so is there funding for development and support? Well, that was one of the big things that Dash made a change for. Zcash did it in a different way. They did venture capital funding, and then they paid the venture capital funding back through the redirection of mining rewards. That's a valid way of doing it also. Ethereum has the Ethereum Foundation, where they get hired to do things. And there's not really a way to fund Bitcoin, although all the different ecosystem partners around it have ways of making money, and by doing that, they are motivated to keep Bitcoin up and running. And then time. So that, can the people that are responsible for the success of the cryptocurrency, can they keep doing this? Now, part of that goes into funding and how well they are at organizing the different people that are part of it. But if you look at the startup space for traditional companies, one of the things that you look at is what their cash burn rate is, and how long can they stay in existence before they have to go get further funding. So that's one of the things that you want to look at, because there are many different abandoned cryptocurrencies that the person who started it or was responsible for running it either ran out of time or ran out of money or ran out of interest. So you got to be able to have something that motivates people, and when they, after a few months or a few years, they're like, wow, you know, I'm putting a lot of time and effort into this, but I'm not making anything out of it. I got to go work my day job. And so how funding is done, there's lots of different ways that funding is done. Some, I think, like Monero, you know, the folks that started it, they held on to a bunch of the cryptocurrency that they mined at the beginning, and as it goes up in value, they're able to sell off a little bit here and there and continue to do well. I think a lot of them are that way. So as long as you have an answer for what the funding is, that's good. Level 4 mining. Once you've been in this cryptocurrency world for a little while and have started researching projects and doing other things, you'll figure out other ways that you can start earning cryptocurrency. So let's talk about some of them. One of them is you can buy some non-mineable cryptocurrency. BitShares is an example of a non-mineable cryptocurrency. There's other ones out there as well. So what can you do with this? Well, some cryptocurrency projects like to have a bit of stability, so they encourage that you hold on to it in a wallet or a node or something like that, and you can earn returns on the cryptocurrency for doing that. One of that is staking. So for example, with Stratus, if you buy Stratus and you keep it in your wallet, your Stratus wallet, and keep that connected to the internet all the time, so that your Stratus wallet is an active node helping to run the Stratus network, you'll get paid a small amount of Stratus periodically. Now, there are some tricks to doing staking. It works better for Stratus and maybe with others if you take whatever amount that you have and divide it up into, I don't know, maybe 8 to 10 different addresses, because when you get rewarded on an address, that address becomes ineligible for staking until the cryptocurrency ages for a little while. There's other ones that are out there also. Masternodes. So Dash popularized masternodes, and it's similar to staking, but you can have your masternode, have your Dash node run on a virtual private server, like a $5 VPS, or you go to a masternode hosting service you keep the cryptocurrency on your own wallet and you do a signature that matches what you've got in your wallet to the masternode that it controls. Right now it takes 1,000 Dash to host one masternode. I think the annual return on it is something like 8% per year. So it's better than doing nothing with your cryptocurrency if you're gonna hold on to it. And like I said earlier, there's other copies of Dash. Probably cost you around $350,000 to get one Dash masternode right now. But if you look at some of the other ones, you can get into them for a bit less. I don't know how long-term and sustainable these projects are, but that's the trade-off. If you get into them early, you can pay less, and you get more reward, but there's also more risk. Service nodes. So service nodes are similar in idea to master nodes. With Zencash, there's service nodes. These are specifically secure nodes that run that maintain certificates and meet different criteria to be able to keep the network up and running. I think you're going to see more service nodes for different cryptocurrencies going forward. So it's an idea where the cryptocurrency protocol rewards folks for running service nodes that perform specific services. Lending. You can, on Poloniex and Bitfinex and other exchanges, you can take your cryptocurrency and use it for margin lending, so for margin traders who want to borrow it. And you can make a decent return on that. The problem is that you keep your cryptocurrency on an exchange, which I'll talk about that a little bit more. I don't encourage keep that on the exchange. But in some cases, if you have a bot that you run and uses an API to the exchange and places those funding and lending orders for you, you can make a good return on your cryptocurrency. And then you can get paid. You can get paid from the projects themselves. You can, if you're big on Bitcoin talk, you probably know about Bitcoin talk signature campaigns. There's Twitter campaigns because people want to get the word out to other potential users that their cryptocurrency exists, and they got to let people know. You can also propose projects, propose work to the different cryptocurrency projects and do the work and get paid for doing that. There's a lot of different things that these projects need to do to be successful, and so if you're a contractor and have some IT skills or marketing skills or do videos or things like that, ask them, hey, you want me to do a video for you? Let's come up with a price, or you know, want me to write a blog post or do something on Steemit? So there's a lot of different things that you can do with whatever skill sets that you have in addition to mining. Okay, level 5 mining. You've been mining your cryptocurrency. You're finding different ways to earn more cryptocurrency. Level 5 is keeping it safe and not losing it. There's a lot of different ways that you can lose your cryptocurrency. So let's talk about a few different ways, if you're going to hold it for a while, that you want to keep it safe. I'm not talking about banks with fiat and the banks supposedly keep your money safe. When you have cryptocurrency, you're responsible for your own cryptocurrency safety, and there's a lot of different ways that you can do this. Okay. You want to maintain positive control. Just like anything else in life, you want to have the ability to control the outcome and not make yourself dependent on others for your success. So in that vein, you got to keep your cryptocurrency off the exchanges as much as possible. Whether the exchanges are good actors or bad actors doesn't matter as much as what the regulators tell them to do. So every country has different regulators, and as we saw in China earlier this year, any regulators can come in and say, boom, all the cryptocurrency that's on your exchanges, nobody can withdraw it. Or they might say, we need to get a list of everything that every one of your users has done on your exchange so that we can go tax them. Or since we've just outlawed this cryptocurrency, so we can take it from them. So if you can do whatever is possible to keep cryptocurrencies within your own control and off exchanges, I highly encourage you to do that. Mine to a software wallet. on your PC or Mac. When I first started mining, I mined to Coinbase, which was easy. I could see the reports of what I was getting. I'd log in. I was happy. Until a couple months later, they're like, hey, you're making a lot of cryptocurrency deposits. What's your business? And in order to maintain a Coinbase account, I had to provide them with the mining facility lease, my power bill, a copy of my business, organizational documents, just about everything. Because exchanges that do have the ability to transfer money from Bitcoin to fiat, at least here in America, they're subject to the Know Your Customer and anti-money laundering provisions. So in order for them to stay in business, they have to ask their customers for all these types of different things. So after that, I stopped mining to Coinbase and started mining to a hardware wallet. And then I learned that if you get too many transactions on a hardware wallet, it makes it really difficult to remove the cryptocurrency from it. So I started mining to a software wallet. And then on that software wallet, every few weeks, I consolidate all those mining transactions and send that cryptocurrency to a hardware wallet for further safekeeping. Or I'll just, for cryptocurrencies that don't have hardware wallet support, I'll take 2 to 3 weeks worth of transactions and send it back to my own wallet, so it takes all those many small transactions and makes it into one big transaction, so that when I need to go send it somewhere else in the future, it doesn't take a long time to chug through. In fact, with some of them, like one that I was mining a while back, I was very limited in how much I could send just because of the number of transactions that I had on the wallet. Okay, so that brings up a next section, encrypt your hard drives. So there's hard drive encryption available, and anytime you encrypt something, make sure that you have multiple ways of getting that encrypted information back. So like on Linux, and I took some of the profits from my cryptocurrency mining and bought myself a really nice laptop. I got a Dell Precision with an i7, 8 cores, 16 gigs of memory, a terabyte SSD, running Ubuntu Linux, and I encrypt the hard drive on it, and that's where I maintain some of my wallets. And Linux got a great backup, so I back up to different hard drives, and I keep those hard drives in different locations. So that, and then furthermore, I test that those backups work and I can actually recover. So I went into one of those hard drives and did a full restoration of the full backup to a different computer, and it worked. So that way you make sure that you don't lose your cryptocurrency. I also run virtual machines. So on my main laptop, I run VirtualBox, and within VirtualBox, I run a copy of Windows. There's some cryptocurrencies that I use that only really have good Windows wallets. And so by having it run in a virtual machine on my Ubuntu Linux box, I'm able to then back up that entire virtual machine. I also do file history within Windows to back up the specific files. So don't lose your cryptocurrencies. VirtualBox KVM. And then anytime you create a wallet, you're going to get a wallet recovery phrase. Well, first off, you want to keep copies of the wallet itself in multiple locations, just in case your main wallet gets corrupt. You also want to get your recovery phrase, like on a hardware wallet, and this is a 12 or 18 or 24 word phrase, write it down on a piece of paper, and then write that down on another piece of paper, and then take those pieces of paper and put them in a really safe place. Probably don't want to use a bank safe deposit box. You might want to use a private service or safes that you own and maintain and keep them in different locations. You definitely don't want to take those recovery phrases for your hardware wallet and type them out in a text file or store them anywhere, because in a lot of cases, it's easy to hack a PC or even a Mac. So anyway, that's level 5 mining, keeping everything safe. It's important to do that if this is going to be your business and this is where you're going to keep your funds going forward. Let's talk a little bit about cash flow. We all got bills to pay. I got electric bills I got to pay, and cryptocurrency mining is actually my main source of income now. It's great because I spend maybe an hour a day working on my stuff, and I get to spend the rest of the time doing things that I like to do. Go exercise, hang out with my kids, do stuff around the house. Fortunately, we've gotten our mining operation to such a point that I'm able to do that. I'm pretty happy about that. However, I do need to have regular dollars to pay the bills. So what are some of the ways that we're able to take these cryptocurrency profits and get regular real world money? Well, one of them is to sell them on an exchange. I do that sometimes. I'll transfer some Bitcoin to Coinbase, and then, or actually the GDAX, the trading platform side, and place some limit orders on it. And when Bitcoin gets to a high enough level, it turns into dollars, and then I transfer those dollars to my bank account. So that's one way to do it. Private party sales. There's some people that don't want to go through exchanges at all that I know. And so by mining the cryptocurrency and putting it to a software wallet and then to a hardware wallet, there's no path where it goes through an exchange. So I'm able to do a private party transaction. Local Bitcoin is an example of a private party transaction for that. You can buy stuff from overseas, which Bitcoin is great for, and then resell it on Amazon, on eBay, however you want. So by buying it in cryptocurrency and then reselling it in fiat, it's a way to convert your cryptocurrency into your regular currency. Okay, so what am I mining these days? Well, if you've watched any of my previous videos, you know that I'm not a big believer in predicting the future, although I do believe that cryptocurrency is going to be around for a while. I like to position myself to be able to take advantage of the different things that come around. So to that, in that vein, the mining facilities that I build out aren't just Bitcoin mining facilities. I get all sorts of different equipment and mine all sorts of different things. And I like to set up my mining stuff not to pool jump, but to mine something consistently for a period of time. And my preference is to get in and mine it while it's early and hold on to it so that it goes up over time. I have Antminer S9s, SHA-256 miners. So right now I'm mining Bitcoin, Bitcoin Cash, and Digibyte with them. I've got Antminer L3 Pluses, which is a script miner, and right now I'm mining Litecoin and using it to mine NiceHash. And actually on one of them I'm also mining Digibyte with that. Antminer D3, I have some of those on the way. I don't have any yet, but I do have Baikal ASIC miners and Iblink miner, and Pinadia. And so with those, I'm mining Dash and Mu, and in some cases NiceHash, and in some cases on the Baikal it has, I think, a qubit miner that I'm able to mine Digibyte. Something like that. I might have that protocol a little bit wrong. I've got AMD R9 GPUs. I've got AMD RX 400 and 500 GPUs. I don't have any NVIDIA GPUs yet, but the R9s and the NVIDIAs are really good for the Equihash mining protocol. So I mine Zencash on those, but you're also able to mine other things like Zcash and Hush and Komodo. And for the AMD RX 400 and 500, those do a little bit better on the ETH hash algorithm. So I mine Ethereum Classic and IVIC, Expanse, Music, and Ethereum. So by mining all these different things and building them up in wallets and then periodically sending some to exchanges to convert to Bitcoin, then taking that Bitcoin back off the exchange and storing it in a hardware wallet, I'm able to use a diversified mining system that I built up over time to buy all these currencies essentially at a discount because we have inexpensive electricity here, hold on to them, and overall grow the business. Hopefully this has been helpful to you folks that are looking at mining or that you're already mining and want to take it to the next level. As always, you know, do things the right way. If you're going to build out a mining facility, make sure that you're doing things safely from an electrical standpoint. And one of the things I always tell people that they're surprised about is the amount of airflow that I put through. I calculate 300 cubic feet per minute per miner. because you don't want hot air recirculating and burning out your components. And don't get too involved in this. You know, enjoy your life and the things that you like to do, and please do continue to mine and build out mining facilities and share the information with others so that we can have a fully distributed cryptocurrency economy worldwide. Check out more information on my YouTube channel and my website, and I'll work to continue to provide good cryptocurrency mining information for y'all going forward. Again, this is Black Ops, Rolf Versus, and thanks. Appreciate it.